Hello and welcome to this presentation on how ECHA has started to contribute to safer drinking water by supporting the implementation of the revised Drinking Water Directive. My name is Panos Arugiannis and I'm a regulatory officer at ECHA's prioritization unit, from where I coordinate the project of ECHA's input to the setting up of the new substance approval system under the revised directive. So let's start with a high-level overview of the directive itself. The revised directive was adopted on the 16th of December last year and came into force on the 12th of January this year. The focus of ECHA's tasks is Article 11. Article 11 creates a new legal framework as it introduces minimum hygiene requirements for materials coming into contact with drinking water while supporting a uniform playing field and the better functioning of the internal market. Beyond the tasks assigned to ECHA, which this presentation will focus on, the revised directive brings about several other changes, including an update to pre-existing safety standards that takes into account the recommendations of the World Health Organization, the introduction of a risk-based approach across the whole of the supply chain, the obligation of access to water with particular protection afforded to vulnerable and marginalized groups, and finally, improved transparency for consumers in relation to the efficiency and effectiveness of the operations of water suppliers across the Union. For now, however, let's turn our focus on Article 11. So, what is the scope of this new Article 11? Firstly, the article applies to materials in new installations, but also repair works or reconstruction in existing installations. Secondly, the requirements of the article extend from the abstraction to the treatment, the storage, and the distribution of drinking water all the way to the tap, but not beyond the tap. Article 11 aims to protect human health by preventing adverse effects on color, odor, taste, and microbial growth, and most importantly for ECHA, the leaching of contaminants into water at higher than necessary levels. All in all, Article 11 focuses on the health and hygiene aspects of contact materials for drinking water. Other aspects, such as product safety, for instance, is covered elsewhere, for example, under the construction products regulations. To achieve its aims, Article 11 creates a regulatory toolbox. Three pillars in this toolbox are of relevance and two involve ECHA directly. Firstly, European positive list of starting substances, compositions, and constituents will be set up. And this is one of the tasks with ECHA's direct involvement. There will be four lists: for organic, metallic, cementitious, enamel, ceramic, and other inorganic materials. This list will contain the only substances, compositions, and constituents authorized for use in contact materials in accordance with Annex 5 of the directive. Secondly, ECHA will collaborate with the Joint Research Center in developing methodologies for testing and accepting starting substances, compositions, and constituents into the European positive lists. Finally, and without ECHA's direct involvement, there will be the development of procedures and methods for testing and accepting final materials. The European Commission will adopt a European standard for testing and assessing products and the introduction of the new EU label that will mark products that are in compliance with the directive. In relation to the timelines involved, a summary is provided in the table you can see on this slide. Starting from the entry into force of the directive in January, member states were given 6 months to notify to ECHA their national positive list and other national provisions. This was indeed completed by the deadline of the 12th of July. Other deadlines relate to the adoption of several legal acts that Article 11 prescribes, of which three are of relevance to ECHA's work. By January 2024, the Commission aims to adopt, with ECHA's and JRC's support, the previously mentioned methodologies for testing and accepting starting substances, compositions, and constituents. This is prescribed under Article 11, Paragraph 2.A, and will be an implementing act. Another implementing act is prescribed under Article 11, Paragraph 2.B. This will bring into legal text the first European positive list with expiry dates per entry. The list should be adopted by January 2025. A third act, a delegated act, prescribed under Article 11, Paragraph 5, will set out in legal text the new procedure for the submission and processing of applications and proposals submitted to ECHA. A deadline for this act has not been specified, but this will have to be achieved by January 2025, the latest, and most probably earlier. The earliest that an application or proposal can be submitted to ECHA will be January 2025. So we have now seen an overview of what Article 11 requires and the associated timelines. The next few slides will present some practical aspects of ECHA's ongoing work. ECHA has been assigned essentially three tasks. Task one is ECHA supporting the Commission in developing the first European positive list over the period January 21 to January 25. Concurrently with task one and over the same period, January 21 to January 25, ECHA's second task will be to set up the procedures and systems which will be necessary for making the European positive list system work. And finally, after this preparatory work has been done, task three will be the actual maintenance of the European positive list through additions, renewals, updates, and removals of entries from January 2025 onwards. The first European positive list, which are currently developing, must be reviewed over a period of 15 years from their adoption. So this is the period 2025 to 2040. So how will the first European positive list be generated under task one? The first list will be based on entries originating from existing national positive lists and other national provisions. In addition, the organic materials positive list will incorporate the plastic food contact materials list of Regulation 10 of 2011. Member states had been given 6 months to notify their list to ECHA, and this has been achieved. It must be noted, however, that only a minority of member states have in place national positive lists. Our next step is to process the information submitted by member states and combine these national submissions into a single positive list for each material category. Then, as far as possible, we aim to review the extent to which the notified lists represent the EU market as a whole. Afterwards, we will assign expiry dates to the entries on the list, and we're currently developing methodologies for doing that. Expiry dates will aim to ensure that the most hazardous entries are reviewed earlier, but also that the application system has the capacity to handle the expected volumes of applications over the 15 years of the review program. The final step will be for the European Commission to adopt the first European positive list into legal text. The Commission is supported by a member state expert group, which helps with the implementation of the directive as a whole. Within that expert group, an internal working group of member states has been created to support ECHA in delivering the task assigned to us under Article 11. This slide provides an early look into how long the first positive list might be. For organic materials, we can identify three key sources: the European Plastic Food Contact Materials list with approximately 900 entries, the core and the combined list of the 4MS initiative with another 300 entries approximately. For those not familiar with this initiative, it comprises Germany, France, the Netherlands, and Denmark alongside the UK. These member states have been collaborating since 2011 in developing methodologies for accepting substances into positive lists for the purposes of their national legislations. We will take their work into account. Finally, for organics, other member states have notified numerous other relevant substances. The exact number is uncertain. Right now, we can disclose that it is higher than 100, just to give you an order of magnitude. For the metals and alloys positive list, two are the key sources: the positive list of the 4MSI initiative, with approximately 50 alloys, and a number of additional alloys notified to ECHA by other member states. Their number is higher than 10. For cementitious substances and constituents, similarly, two key sources are relevant: the positive list generated by the 4MSI initiative, with approximately 200 entries, and a number of additional entries notified to ECHA by other member states. Their number is higher than 100. Finally, the last list for enamels, ceramics, and other inorganic materials, this seems to be the shortest. It brings together around 10 compositions from the 4MSI positive list and a similar number notified by other member states. Now, regarding task two, while the European positive lists are being put together, ECHA is undertaking a significant volume of scientific work aimed at the development of the backbone of the application system under the directive. This comprises first setting out the information requirements that need to be met by applications and proposals that will be submitted to ECHA from January 2025 onwards. These information requirements will cover substance and composition identity, hazard information, and importantly, data on migration into the drinking water. We are also documenting relevant risk assessment methods, which will be presented in guidance documents. On the other hand, a new application procedure will need to be built, will need to be documented, and then adopted into legal text. This will capture the requirements for the submission of applications and proposals to ECHA. Please note those two terms. Application is a term we use to refer to a dossier submitted to ECHA by industry, while a proposal is to be submitted by an authority. Beyond the submission stage, we are currently developing the procedure through which ECHA's Committee for Risk Assessment, the RAC, will develop an opinion on each valid dossier submitted to ECHA. Finally, as the application procedure will be fully IT supported, the IT systems required for this are also in preparation. Applications and proposals will use the Euclid format, which many of you are likely to be familiar with already. Our aim is to be ready by January 2024, so that applicants and authorities will have sufficient time to familiarize themselves with the new system and the new requirements before everything goes live in 2025. And finally, task three, the maintenance of the European positive list. This slide tries to give a high-level concept of our approach, and I must be clear that there are many details that have not been decided and many changes are likely to happen between now and the adoption of the system. So please take this as an early indication of what the application process might look like. So at the top of the scheme, you can see some key actors. On the left-hand side, industry. On the right-hand side, we have member states. Industry may apply to ECHA, submitting an application to ECHA to either add a new entry into one of the European positive lists, or more frequently we expect to submit a review application to retain an existing entry into its European positive list. On the other hand, member states may submit a proposal to ECHA, for instance, to add a new entry into one of the European positive lists, or perhaps to update an entry because some new information has come to light, or maybe to remove an entry because of its hazard. In either case, applications and proposals will be subject to technical and content checks by ECHA to ensure that data requirements have been met, the correct format and templates have been used, and generally the information that has been submitted to ECHA is usable. After those checks, the applications or proposals will be subject to a period of consultation of interested parties. So the information presented in applications and proposals, together with anything useful that comes from the consultation phase, will be forwarded to the Committee for Risk Assessment, the RAC, by which an opinion will be generated. The opinion of the RAC will be forwarded to the European Commission, and finally it will be a decision by the Commission whether to accept or reject the application or proposal, leading to an update of the relevant European positive list. As shown also on the left-hand side of the slide, we envisage a self-maintained mechanism to be embedded into the process. By this, I mean that if an expiry date for a substance on one of the lists comes, but nobody has submitted an application to support the substance, to review the substance, then the substance will be removed from the list. I hope this slide gives you some initial ideas, and I will repeat again that there is plenty to be decided upon and changes are likely to happen between now and the adoption of the procedure. So, as we're reaching the end of this presentation, let's take a look into the future. As a result of the adoption of the European positive list into legal text in early 2025, new obligations will arise for economic operators in the EU supply chain for materials coming into contact with drinking water. With the term economic operator, we refer to a manufacturer, an importer, a distributor, or a professional user of starting substances, compositions, or constituents, or even materials, or final products, or even an only representative of a company based outside the EU. It should be remembered that once a substance is added to one of the European positive lists, its use in the manufacture of contact materials will be possible for all relevant economic actors. So January 2025 is an important milestone. Before that, relevant national legislation and other national provisions will remain in force, and where there are existing national positive lists, these will be subject to maintenance, which means maybe new substances will be added or existing substances will be updated. Similarly, the EU food contact materials legislation will remain in force with the normal maintenance of the EU plastic materials positive list. It is important to note, however, that the EU legislation on food contact materials will be subject to revision in coming years. The details on the direction such changes may take are yet unknown. After the adoption of the European positive list, this new list will play a central role as they will show which substances, compositions, or constituents will be allowed for use. Where industry has an interest in using a new substance, that substance will need to be applied for a TECA. But also, very importantly, all substances listed will need to be periodically reviewed by submitting review applications to ECHA before their expiry dates. Finally, for applications that have been submitted to ECHA, the Committee for Risk Assessment may request additional information in order to develop its opinion. The applicant will be obliged to supply this. So, to summarize, here are four take-home messages on what lies ahead for the revised Drinking Water Directive. For starting, substances, compositions, and constituents of drinking water contact materials, new obligations will arise from January 2025. These new obligations will be defined by information requirements and risk assessment methods which are currently in preparation. To deliver this, ECHA is working closely with DG Environment of the European Commission, the Joint Research Center, Member States, but also DG Sante and the European Food Safety Authority to ensure proper links to the food contact materials legislation. This preparatory work will take into consideration past work in all relevant fields, including REACH, biocides, the food contact materials legislation, and of course the work of the 4MSI initiative. In parallel, a new application system to support a new application process is in preparation. Applications will be made in the Euclid format, which should be familiar to those who have previously interacted with ECHA in the context of the REACH regulation. Finally, existing national positive lists have already been communicated to ECHA by the member states. This national list will be the basis for creating the first European positive list for contact materials for drinking water. The entries on this list will be prioritized with expiry dates that will be systematically assigned using a methodology that ECHA is currently developing. Finally, although I will not go through the next slide, I encourage you all to take a look at the list of useful resources and contact details that are provided in it. I hope you have found this presentation useful and informative. Thank you for your attention, and I look forward to any questions you may have.